Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Welcome to the weekly top three, the top three things on our mind here at Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets for the week of January 18th, 2021. The weekly top three is a regular segment on the Michael Duke Show. The show broadcasts on Facebook Live and via streaming audio from the show's website weekdays from 6 to 8 a.m. I join Michael weekly in the first hour of Tuesday's show from 6:25 to 7 a.m. for a discussion between the two of us about our three issues. We post the podcast of our discussion following the show on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook, YouTube, SoundCloud, and Spotify pages, also on the new Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets website, as well as the project's page on national blog site, medium.com. You can find past episodes of the weekly top three also at the same locations. Keep in mind that in addition to these podcasts, during the week, you also can follow and participate in the discussion with us of these and other issues affecting Alaska's fiscal and economic condition by following us on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook page and through our posts on Twitter. This week, our top three issues are these. First, the myopia in a recent ADN editorial is adding to the state's fiscal problem, not the solution. Second, Representative Prax's and others' approach to the state's fiscal problem is only leading to deeper PFD cuts. And third, a piece by the Manhattan Institute's Brian Riedl goes to the heart of what is creating the nation's deep partisan divide. And now, let's join Michael.
Well, let's dive down into the weekly top three this week, Brad. First and foremost, you've got a little bit of heartburn with this latest editorial that came out from the ADN editorial board talking about the PFD. You called it, in fact, I think you called it myopic. Let's talk for a bit about that. What's the deal?
So it was an editorial that ran over the weekend. The headline is "What to Watch for as the Legislative Session Begins." And by the way, beginning with today's show, I've started posting the articles that we're going to be talking about on the show on the Common Sense Core page as well as my pages. So if people want to go back and read these articles afterwards, they're posted out there. But this is an editorial. The headline is "What to Watch for as the Legislative Session Begins," and they list three things: caucus formation, and which Dunleavy will show up, which is a good question. But the third one they list is the multi-billion dollar question. And then they spend the entire time talking about the PFD. Will the PFD be cut? Will it be converted to government? Will it be a big PFD, a small PFD? And they, you know, if you think I get sarcastic about things, they get a little bit overboard sarcastic about people who support big PFDs in this piece. What bothers me, and where I think we've gone wrong in the past, and where I think we're going to go wrong even worse in the future if we keep going down this road, is they're asking the wrong question. They're focusing the entire revenue question on the PFD. And really, the question really is: should the PFD be big? Should it be small? Should we convert it to government? Should it be used this way or that way? To me, that's become the wrong question. The question is: how are we going to fund government? PFD cuts is one way to do it. PFD taxes, essentially, is one way to do it. But there are a myriad of other ways to do it. And by focusing on the PFD, you get everybody all stirred up about whether the PFD ought to be big or not, when the real question is should we be raising revenue? And if we should, what's the best way to raise revenue? We know from the 2016 ICER study, we know that using PFD cuts to raise revenue has the largest adverse impact on the overall economy and is by far the least equitable in terms of its impact on middle and lower income Alaska families. It takes the most from them, takes a trivial amount from the top 20%, takes nothing from non-residents in contributing toward the cost of government. Yet the ADN editorial, you know, focusing on these three issues, makes the PFD the sole revenue issue, focuses on it as the sole way to raise revenues. And I think that's I think that's just asking the wrong question, and it's being excessively myopic, focused on just the PFD as the option. It yeah. is the way that the top 20% want us to think about the issue,
right?
Because using PFD cuts benefits them hugely, but it is the wrong way to really think about the issue in terms of trying to find a solution that has a low impact on the overall Alaska economy and on Alaska families.
Well, Brad, I mean, I hate to accuse you of being naive, because I don't think you're that, but I mean, it does sound a little naive when if you're not at least admitting that the possibility is they're trying to frame the argument. See, they don't want to talk about all this. If they treat it like this and they talk about it like this and they talk about the PFD with disdain and everything else, then they can frame the whole argument that this is really the only option on the table. And you could see that attitude in this piece. The sentence that leaped out to me in this portion of it that talks about the multi-billion-dollar question is the sentence that says, over the course of several decades, Alaska's grand experiment of the PFD has morphed into a form of universal basic income, a far cry from its original intent. And I'm just like, wait a second. It didn't morph. The statute remains the same. Everything else remains the same. What has morphed is politicians' attitude towards it, where they see it as a piggy bank and they see it as government money instead of the people's money, which was the original intent of it.
No, I if I were arguing that that the PFD, well, anyway, maybe it is a little naivete. I mean, we've talked in the past about the ADN having a slant, and I think what I'm trying to say is the ADN is continuing down this road of having a slant by trying to frame the issue totally around the PFD. And yes, that's the way that the ADN and some of their writers, Charles Wolfers and others, have done it in the past. That is the top 20% way of trying to describe the issue. But what I'm saying is the wrong way. It's the wrong way to deal with the issue. The issue is, how are we going to pay for government? The questions ought to be, what approach has the lowest overall impact on the Alaska economy? What approach is the fairest to Alaska families? That ought to be the question that we're trying to answer as we deal with revenue. And yes, the ADN is trying to slide the question, is trying to phrase the question entirely differently, try to focus entirely differently to slant the debate. But all I'm saying is they're slanting it. They are slanting it, and Right. They're slanting it in the wrong direction.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And again, ignoring, I mean, we keep going back. We sound like a broken record, keep going back to this ICER commentary. But the bottom line is that it still holds true. You want to affect the Alaska economy more than anything else. You want to affect the lowest income earners of the Alaska economy the most on top of all that. Then, you know, go ahead and take the PFD. But they completely ignore that component of it. But like you said, the top 20% are all okay with that because, you know, it doesn't really affect me. I mean, am I going to lose sleep over the price of a cheeseburger, you know, versus, you know, somebody who's in the lower income bracket where it's the size of a price of a car or something? I mean, it's a significant change.
Yeah, exactly right. And the ADN just keeps, I mean, the ADN and other news media, it's not just the ADN, but this editorial really brought it home. The ADN just wants to keep the focus on the PFD. And I think that has, I mean, that's prolonging this debate. If we were having a debate about what the right way to raise revenue was, then the top, and we were talking about broad-based approaches, you would, and we've talked about this before on the show, but you would find Natasha and others talking about, oh, we need to cut the cost of government because they don't want to contribute to the revenue side. As long as the debate is focused entirely on cutting the PFD, which doesn't affect them at all, as long as the debate is focused entirely on cutting the PFD, they don't care about spending levels because it's not affecting them. So this myopia, this focus entirely on the PFD, whether it's intended to slant, whether it's just they can't get their minds around anything more broad, it is leading this debate, constantly leading this debate down the wrong road. It's pitting lower and middle and lower income Alaska families against top 20% Alaska families, instead of pitting all of us against government spending levels. It's dividing us in a way that I don't think ever leads to reducing the cost of government. and a focus on reducing the cost of government, because you've got a significant share of the top 20% who don't care about the cost of government, because they're insulated from having to pay for it. So the ADN just keeps going down this same road of focusing on the PFD, and I think it's misleading the debate. I think it's misleading the discussion, and doing a disservice to the state.
So we look at this, we could see it's myopic, we could see how they're framing the debate, we could see that they're, again, entrenched in this idea that the PFD really is the only option, which of course precludes a discussion of new revenues. It also precludes any discussion of reducing the size and scope of government, which seems, quite honestly, I mean, we're still going to keep fighting for it on the program here, but it seems like it's a lost cause. And of course, all the people in the chat room are like, cut government, cut government, cut government. We can echo chamber ourselves to death in here, but nobody else seems to be really talking about that. A few of the newer legislative representatives are mentioning it and talking about it a little bit, but there is no political will to cut any further. In fact, all we hear about is, well, we just can't cut any. We've cut it to the bone. I'm not saying that we should stop talking about cutting, but we got to stop looking at cuts as the only solution, because nobody else is talking about it.
And part of the reason for that, Michael, is we're not talking about revenues which would impact the top 20%. As long as they're able to steer the discussion in the direction of using PFD cuts, which affect only middle and lower income Alaska families, as long as they're able to steer the discussion in that direction, they're indifferent to spending cuts. Natasha's indifferent. Heck, 80% of the legislature is in the top 20%. 80% is indifferent personally to the impact of spending, because they don't pay a significant share of it in terms of PFD cuts. So as long as the discussion is steered in that fashion, you're not going to find the top 20%
right
talking about spending cuts.
Exactly. I mean, I don't want to beat a dead horse here, but I'm going to beat on it a little bit here. Again, people keep saying, well, if we just need to reduce, we just need to reduce. I agree. I mean, Brad agrees. The problem is, if we're only talking about it amongst ourselves, and yet none of the movers and shakers and the powers that be want to even address it, we're going to have to start thinking about maybe taking a different tact in this war, right? I mean, this is about tactics. We're going to have to start taking a different tact in this war. If all they want to talk about is taking the PFD and utilizing that as new revenue, maybe we need to offer an alternative new revenue. And then again, once they start paying their fair share of it or their kick on it and they start feeling the pinch, then maybe cuts will be back on the table. Brad.
No, exactly right, Michael. I mean, exactly right. The cuts only... The last stand of cuts only was in Governor Dunleavy's first budget, when he did make proposed deep cuts. We saw the pushback that got. We saw the fact that he couldn't get that through the legislature. He couldn't get 16 in the legislature to back him up on those deep cuts. We ended up with watered down cuts that ultimately sort of got watered to the point that we ended up with a slightly higher amount of spending as a result. We saw the recall petition start and how that's affected the governor. That was the run up the hill, banners flying, cuts only. We're gonna take the hill with cuts only. That was the ultimate charge, and it got repelled. And the governor has done two budgets since last year and this year's, and neither has replicated the cuts only approach, and neither has tried to frankly even materially reduce spending. We see the governor's 10-year plan this year. It's got billion-plus-dollar deficits as far as the eye can see. Some cuts in there, and the pushback has already started against even those cuts. But we're not going to see cuts. And here's. We've talked about it before on the program, but it bears repeating. Here's what's going on. There's an unholy alliance between the top 20% and those who want to maintain government spending. The deal is this. The deal is the top 20% has agreed that they won't go after government spending as long as those who want to continue government spending don't go after the top 20% income, as long as they continue to use PFD cuts, which don't land on the top 20%. And that unholy alliance is what you know, rebutted Governor Dunleavy's efforts 2 years ago is what has caused the governor not to undertake cuts again. If you get it, if you do a revenue structure that takes money from the top 20% on the same basis as you're taking money from middle and lower income Alaska families, if you engage them in the battle, you bring to bear the top 20%, the donor class, the class that a lot of the legislators come from. You bring that into the battle with you. You bring that segment onto the field. They start pushing back against spending because they're going to have to pay a share of it. As long as they're able to use this revenue mechanism that pushes it to middle and lower income Alaska families, they aren't going to fight back on spending. Spending is going to continue, and we're going to continue to have deep PFD cuts. So it's you're exactly right, Michael. We need to change the course of the battle to engage all Alaskans in pushing back on spending, not just the bottom 80% that are having to bear the cost and burden of it now.
Kevin asked to talk about the multiplier effect of private money versus government money in the economy, which I just touched on when I was talking about, you know, the money being drawn out of the economy. An ICER report has touched on it. I got about a minute here, Brad, if you want to give us your quick thoughts on the private money versus government money in the economy.
Well, the ICER study in 2016 touched on that as well, and found that the multiplier on PFD cuts, the negative multiplier, if you will, was greater than any other revenue option. And so it found that you hurt the economy most by PFD cuts.
Anthony says, the PFD, even being loosely compared to universal basic income or a handout, is the byproduct of an out-of-control spending of the government and the basic cost of living being so bloated that unless you work for the government, it's nearly impossible to live here. Getting rid of the PFD, giving it to the government, whatever, the net result is still that the upper 15% of the well-off people won't lose a blink of sleep, but Joe Beercan won't be able to afford to live here. I mean, I think that kind of encapsulates our whole argument in a nutshell. Thank you, Anthony, for that comment. Well, let's move on to number two, and we'll get a quick tease of it here before we take a break. There's another piece in the Fairbanks Daily Newsminer, which I posted up in the chat room, talking about how that the finances of the state are going to be the top legislative issue, which I say, duh, because we got a $2.4 billion deficit. And there's a bunch of different local interior legislators that are quoted in here. But you seem to be picking out Mike Prax as one that probably has it wrong. And I think that our previous discussion right this second here kind of leads into that. Quickly, give us a snapshot here.
It does. They quote a bunch of different the interior delegation, the ones who are willing to talk about the issue. Kawasaki and Thompson weren't willing to talk, so there's no quotes from them. But Representative Prax, who I think does an excellent job, is quoted in one of the segments, and the quote is, if you're thinking about new revenue, you're thinking about taking from some and giving to others. And I think that's wrong. I think that's wrong. When we're talking about new revenue, when we're talking about any revenue, we're talking about paying for the costs of government. Now, government does a lot of things that benefit a lot of people. I mean, roads benefit a lot of people. Police benefit a lot of people. Health and social services benefit a lot of people. Education benefit a lot of people. We're talking about paying for the cost of government. We're not talking about wealth transfers, all revenues being wealth transfers. We're talking about paying for the cost of government. And when you phrase it the way that Mike does, when you phrase it as if you're talking about any new revenue, you're talking about taking from some and giving to others, I think you foreclose really thinking through how this issue ought to play out. And that's what we'll talk about in our second segment.
Well, and maybe they haven't thought it out far enough, because if you're thinking about new revenue, you're thinking about taking from some and giving to others. Sounds exactly like what's been happening with the PFD. I mean, quite honestly. I mean, you're thinking about taking it from some, the lowest income earners, and giving it to others. I mean, I think that pretty much sums up exactly what we've been talking about. We're continuing now on the weekly top two, or top three. We're on to two of the top three. We're talking about a local article from the Fairbanks Daily Newsminer, where they got a chance to interview a bunch of the interior delegation to talk about finances and the PFD and new revenues and everything else. And Mike Prax is quoted as saying in there, if you're thinking about new revenue, you're thinking about taking from some and giving to others. He's speaking in opposition to any new revenue, any new taxes, while ignoring the fact, I think, that the current cut of the PFD is a tax, in fact, on the lower, you know, 80 percentile, heavily on the lower 50 percentile of the state of Alaska. Brad's going to continue to flesh out his thoughts. Brad?
Well, here's the deal. As long as we oppose any new revenue, we're going to continue to have PFD cuts. I mean, as we just spent the first segment talking about, as long as the top 20% don't have to pay for the cost of government, they're going to be implicitly agreeing with those who want to continue spending as it is. So as long as we're saying nope, no new revenue, we're not going to talk about new revenue. We're not going to even take on the issue of revenue sources. We just want, you know, we're going to keep charging up this spending cuts only hill, and holding our breath and saying we won't talk about new revenue. As long as we're doing that, PFD cuts will continue, because spending will continue. We don't have 21 in the legislature, 21 and 11 in the legislature, who are going to push back on spending. As long as we don't engage the top 20%, we're going to continue to have spending. As long as we continue to have spending, we're going to continue to have deficits. As long as we continue to have deficits, we're going to continue to have PFD cuts if we don't have another revenue source. So going down this road of saying, nope, not going to talk about new revenue, I'm only going to think about it as wealth transfers or bad things, not going to talk about it, going to hold my breath. As long as we're doing that, we're going to keep on going down the same road. I can absolutely tell you, if we're still talking about this in 2025, Michael, we will still be railing against PFD cuts, because that is the way that the legislature is going to keep closing this. And as we found out, the legislature can do it alone by just cutting the PFD appropriation. The governor can't override that, and they'll just keep doing it year after year after year. So that's the direction we're going. That's the direction we've been going the last 5 years. That's the direction we'll keep going over the next 5 years. Maybe it's too much to ask Mike to do this. Maybe it's too much to ask others to do this. But if you start talking about revenue separate apart from the PFD, just skip the PFD. We've got a deficit. We need to close it. We need to close it with revenue. We need to close it with equitable revenue. And we need to close it with revenue that has the lowest impact on the overall economy. That means that will translate into a broad-based revenue source. That will mean the top 20% are going to contribute to the cost of government. Non-residents are going to contribute to the cost of government. And all of a sudden, we will find people talking about, oh, my gosh, we're spending too much on this. We're spending too much on that. We will engage the class. We will engage the top 20%. We will engage legislators who otherwise are immune from the effects of this because of their wealth and income. We will engage people in bringing spending under control, and that's why I have trouble with when I see this stuff from Mike and others about we're just not going to talk about new revenue. I mean, I know where that goes. We've seen where it goes for the last 5 years. It goes to PFD cuts, and that's where it's going to continue to go. So if you want, if you're satisfied with PFD cuts, if you think that's an okay way to raise revenue, then fold your arms and say you're not going to talk about new revenue sources, because that's exactly what's going to happen. We're going to continue to have PFD cuts. But if you really want to get this state under control, if you really want to get revenues that are fair and equitable and have the least adverse impact on the overall economy, then you need to talk about a broader scale of revenues. You need to unfold your arms, open your mind, and talk about a broader set of revenues. I mean, I understand why Mike's doing it. I understand why people fold their arms and say, no, we're not going to talk about new revenues. But I'm telling you, we've seen for the last 5 years where that goes, and that goes to continued PFD cuts. And that's not going to change over the next 5 years or the next 10 years, as long as we continue to close our minds to alternatives.
Now, Anthony brings up another interesting point, which I want you to take on real quick before we move on to number three. And he says, all I'm saying is this giving more money to the state government is like handing your savings to a stock manager you know is a gambling addict. We don't get to complain when he burns our funds on online poker when we knew full and well he wasn't trustworthy. The only argument that I would offer in that, and Brad could comment on it, is that I would agree giving them more revenue is not necessarily a good thing. I mean, I don't necessarily trust them. But if the revenue stream also comes from that top 20%, they will be more fully engaged and be more likely to be looking to reduce the size and scope of government. Maybe that spending argument can then be on the table.
That's exactly right. But the other thing to keep in mind is the legislature already has revenue. I mean, we keep talking about giving them more revenue. They already have revenue. They have the full PFD. I mean, they can convert the entire thing to government spending. It's not like we can prevent them from having revenue. The way the PFD is set up, they always have access to it. The way the Supreme Court is held in 2017, they always have access to it. So it's not like we can starve them by saying no revenue. They've already got the PFD. The question is, what's the right revenue source? What revenue source has the lowest adverse impact on the overall economy? What's the fairest to Alaskans? And what's the most likely to engage the top 20% in pushing back on spending? They're not doing it now, and we need to find a way to engage them to push back on it.
Absolutely. And again, I'm seeing a lot of it in the chat room of, well, Brad just wants to talk about taxes. Brad just, you know, we don't need to do that. We just need to revenues and spending and cuts. And again, we're not against cuts. You're not against cuts. I'm not against cuts. I'm a little more cautious about trying to give the state more money at this time than you are. But the bottom line is your argument still is persuasive to say the only way that these people are going to care about cuts, care about cuts is when they have to pay part of the bill. When somebody else is paying part of the bill, it's not an important deal. I mean, if I'm making a $500,000 a year, and that $2,000 dividend really doesn't mean anything to me, then I don't really care if the government's taking it and spending it because it's really not bugging me that much. If somebody's making $20,000 a year and loses that $2,000, it really, truly affects them. Now, if everybody was paying that 10% of their income and all of a sudden they had to write a $50,000 check from their $500,000 income, all of a sudden they might be a little more interested in the direction the government's taking.
Yeah, and Michael, one point. I'm not talking about more money. I've never talked about more money. I'm talking about substitute, alternative, better ways. If we've got to raise revenue, better ways to raise revenue. I'm not suggesting that we layer on another, $500 million or whatever the amount is on top of government and let them spend that. I'm talking about restoring $500 million of PFD cuts. And substituting $500 million of alternative revenue sources. People say, well, the government will just take that $500 million and add it to the $500 million they've already got, and they'll spend that. Okay, fine. There's a way to handle that. And the way to handle that is to combine Bill Willikowski's proposed constitutional amendment, SJR 1, with Jonathan Kreis Tompkins, HJR 1, which sets a limit on permanent fund draws. Combine those two together, make it a constitutional amendment, and insist on that as any part of revenue package, as any part of a revenue package. Combine that with Adam Wool's HB 37, for example, and insist on that as a package. That way, you lock in the fact that we have a PFD. It's not gonna be cut by government anymore. But we still have a deficit, and here's the way we're gonna handle the deficit. That will take away, the argument that that you're just trying to give the government more money. This isn't about more money. This is about finding better ways, lower impact, more equitable ways to raise the revenue the government's otherwise going to be raising through PFD cuts. It's a way of treating all Alaska families equitably as opposed to forcing the obligation primarily on middle and lower income Alaska families.
And I think that's the important part. But again, you say that you're not about new revenues for the state, but again, or more revenues, I guess I should say. But the bottom line is that that's how people see it, and that's how they feel these politicians are going to use it. I think that's the fear, is that if we give them more revenue, they will spend more revenue because that has been their track record heretofore.
And Michael, if that's the analysis that we keep going down and using that as an excuse not to look at substitute revenue sources, all that's going to do is continue PFD cuts. The deficits aren't going to go away. They certainly aren't going to go away as long as the top 20% don't, as long as the donor class doesn't have to pay for them. The deficits aren't going to go away. And if we continue refusing to talk about alternatives or substitute revenue sources, just folding arms and saying no, then that's fine. They're going to continue using PFD cuts. They're going to continue to focus on middle and lower income Alaska families and in a way that has the largest adverse impact on Alaska families. That's the future. That's been the past 5 years. That's the future. So it's really, I mean, if you're fine with PFD cuts, keep folding your arms and saying, no, I'm not going to discuss new revenues. But if you want to find a better way to do this, a way that engages all Alaskans in bringing the cost of government down, in lowering spending, if you want to find a way to do that, then you need to say, okay, I'm willing to talk about substitute revenues, not more revenues, but substitute revenues, replacing this reliance on PFD cuts and doing it in a way that's more equitable.
Brad Keithley, Alaska's for Sustainable Budgets. All right, you've beaten everybody up, Brad. Leave us with some hope here. Give us some thoughts here before we go. We've got about a minute.
I think there is hope, Michael. We talked about it last week. I just mentioned it again. I think it's a combination of HJR1, JKT's bill, Willikowski's permanent fund dividend constitutionalization, and Adam Wool's HB 37, which is a broad-based revenue source that engages everybody in cutting spending. There is a solution at the end of this tunnel. And it's a better solution than where we've come to the last 5 years and where we're headed for the next 5 years. But people have to open their minds to talk about substitute revenue sources to get to that better solution. As long as people are just folding their arms and saying, nope, not going to talk about it, we're not going to get there. But there is a very good solution at the end of this if people will just open their minds and think about it.
Brad Keithley, Alaska's for Sustainable Budgets. Thank you, my friend. I appreciate you coming on board. Like I said, not everybody is as excited as I am about talking with you about this stuff, but I think it's supremely important. I think we have to delve down into these questions. Otherwise, we're kidding ourselves if we think anything is going to change at that point. Let's move on to number three. You said there's an important piece from conservative writer Brian Riedl, talking about the facts that we take on faith, posting it up in the chat room. Give us your thoughts on number three here.
This is the best piece I have seen from any side about the problem we've got with the partisan divide in America and the problem that we've got with, you know, into two warring camps that we've sort of fallen into in America. Brian is a conservative. Nobody can challenge his conservative credentials. He is a conservative economist who is with the Manhattan Institute, a highly conservative organization. Brian, I first got to know Brian through his work on economics. He's one of the best conservative voices on economics out there. Brian, this piece is in response to the insurrection at the Capitol last week or 2 weeks ago now, and really was motivated by Brian taking a deep look at what is causing this split in America. And I think it's a long piece, but I think it's an excellent piece. If there's one piece that I would say that I would want people to read to try to understand what's going on and ways to fix it, it would be Brian's. These couple of sentences, I think, are the heart of it. Finally, perhaps most importantly, we should rely on diverse sources of information. It is not rare for one article to read like a devastating bulletproof argument for a certain viewpoint, only to be successfully shredded by a rebuttal article elsewhere. Only in a real competition can the best data, ideas, and arguments prevail. Read the smartest analysis from the right, center, and left, if for no other reason than to understand better those whom you oppose. Avoid echo chambers. Brian is really trying to get at the heart of what's dividing America and really trying to identify a path forward, which is engage others, talk to others, listen to others, read a variety of sources, and then make your judgments out of that. A point earlier in the piece is all we're doing is basically said we're half of us are reciting National Review, half of us are citing a New Republic, and we're bouncing forth between those two. Read both, decide for yourself what's the better of the two, but read both and understand where the arguments are, and then make decisions as opposed just to being an echo chamber for one side or the other. Great piece. I highly recommend that people read it.
Wait, you mean that the answer to speech that you don't agree with is more speech? I mean, wait a second. That just flies in the face of everything that we're talking about.
I heard that on a radio show once, on a morning radio show.
I mean, right, exactly. I mean, wait a second. We're supposed to be able to argue it and talk about it. I mean, this is the problem that we're facing today, is that more people are not looking at this and saying, oh, okay, I don't agree with that. Okay, well, tell me why. What is the argument? But instead, they go back to their little pockets of whatever, including social media, where it is an echo chamber, and they're, oh, see, these people agree with me, I must be right. I mean, people have got to have their ideas challenged, and I think that's what we've lost here in America, for sure.
Challenged and discussed. I mean, challenged and treated fairly, as Brian puts it, a competition of ideas. I mean, we talk about competition being good in economics. We talk about competition being good in the marketplace. What Brian is suggesting is we have a competition of ideas in our discussion about politics. But competition requires that you know. I mean, competition in the marketplace is you know what the prices are that everybody's offering. Competition in economics is you know what the argument is that everybody's making, and you're rebutting it. You're using facts and argument. The problem is, I mean, what Brian's pointing out is the competition in politics is we're not doing competition. We're locking in on one side or the other, not reading the other side, not understanding the other side, not seeking, you know, to the benefits of competition to find the best path forward. I think it's a great article. I mean, I think it just really goes to the heart of what's going on here. And as I say, I highly recommend it.
Brad Keithley, Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Brad, thank you so much for coming on board this morning. We appreciate you being part of it.
Michael, as always, thanks for having me.
Well, that's a wrap for another week's edition of the Weekly Top 3 from Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Thank you again for joining us. Remember that you can find past episodes on our YouTube, SoundCloud, and Spotify pages, and keep track of us during the week on Facebook and Twitter. This has been Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. We look forward to you joining us again next week on the Weekly Top 3.